So, here's a little childhood story for you. One of the earliest memories I can remember is waiting for my parents to pick me up from my primary school. I've never been one to use playsets much, so more often than not, I ended up hanging out near the back of the school, in the small parking lot with the sports field just beside it. I recall ending a long day at school, sitting down on the step of the back lot's exit, my backpack strapped on tightly and something in my hand. A thick book with a worn spine and slightly brown pages. A book that my 6-year-old self had already read over and over, practically religiously. That book? Marvel Comics' Astonishing Ant-Man Essential, Volume 1. Collecting Tales to Astonish, number 27 and 35-69. Wanna take a guess who my favorite superhero was growing up? Even before being introduced to the MCU, Ant-Man was a character I had an immense attachment to, or more specifically, Henry Hank Pym. Scott's a great character and all, but I was always more interested in the scientist who preferred to think his way through problems, as opposed to using physical violence. The intellectual angle taken by Pym's solutions to his stories interested me just as much as Iron Man's constant technological progression, or the Avengers' conflicts against foes no enemy could face alone. Both books that I also owned in essential form, but something about Pym always captivated me. Perhaps I can thank Avengers, Earth's Mightiest Heroes for that. The incredible television show was just as formative for my childhood self as the comics were, and thank goodness for that. As already discussed by Pillar of Garbage in his video on how Avengers, Earth's Mightiest Heroes updates the comics, the show takes the ideas displayed in the original comics run and gives it a rebirth of sorts to better fit the contemporary value of the 2010s. In addition to Pym's intellect, strategy, and compassion for his fellow life, the show likewise gives Pym a new core value that defines his character. Pacifism. Hank is willing to fight, but will always look for a better option and offers therapy and rehabilitation to the villains he ends up being responsible for. But Hank isn't known for being a pacifist, for being smart and compassionate. Among the general public, the most well-known thing about Hank is that he hit his wife during a mental breakdown. That sounds pretty out of character for the guy I've been describing so far. How did he get to such a low point? Simple answer? Yellow Jacket. Over the course of 2 decades, Hank Pym went through several different secret identities. Ant-Man was only the first. As soon as the second issue of Avengers, he'd taken on the identity of Giant Man in the pages of Tales to Astonish, putting more focus on the increased size that came from this identity. Upon its retirement and eventual return, he was stuck in a 10-foot body and took on the identity of Goliath. And then, when this mentality of compassion was abandoned, Yellow Jacket came to the forefront. That's 4 identities within the span of 6 years. While EMH skipped over both Giant Man and Goliath as their own identities, Hank's rejection of his Ant-Man identity and adoption of the Yellow Jacket name and mentality happened in the show in a similar way to how it happened in the comics. But considering one of these stories happened all the way back in the 60s and another happened in the early 2010s, I'm interested in comparing and contrasting these 2 similar yet different tales. So sit back and let's take a look at the fall of Pym and the rise of Yellow Jacket. Night brings out the best in some men and the worst in others. Before being introduced to Yellowjacket in Avengers Volume 1, number 59, let's look back a little to the history of Hank Pym with the team. Serving as a founding Avenger under the name of Ant-Man, Pym was going by Giant-Man by the time of the team's second meeting and fought at their side until the final conflict with the first Baron Zemo, where he aimed to retire from superheroics to focus on science and a life with Janet. That didn't last for long, as a conflict with Namor Villainatuma, an Elder of the Universe collector, caused Pym to jump back into action. However, the constant use of Pym particles took an immense physical strain on his body, trapping him in a 10-foot form until he regained control of his shrinking abilities. Add to this the accidental creation of Ultron, and the guilt consuming him over that, plus a desire to ask the Wasp for her hand in marriage? It's easy to see why Hank would be emotionally distraught at the time. Oh, but that's just the beginning. As issue 59 opens, the first page shows some robbers nabbing some fur coats before Yellowjacket arrives. He then proceeds to violently beat the criminals and stays on the scene until the cops arrive, where he makes his stance on the law perfectly clear.
The witness stand is for stoolies, Clyde. I play cops and robbers. Let somebody else play judge and jury.
Yellowjacket then makes sure that the cops will tell the press about what happened, as he evidently wants his name out there. Cut to Avengers Mansion, where the team is in the middle of a training session. When Wasp arrives without Hank, she points out the odd nature of Hank's absence from an Avengers meeting, especially since Black Panther was told to expect Hank early. A brief glimpse into the personal troubles of each standing Avenger, currently counting Wasp, Black Panther, Vision, and Hawkeye, confirms Hank's workaholic nature, as Wasp recalls Hank being unable to accept her date invitation due to an experiment. But the pondering of the team is interrupted, as Edwin Jarvis, Flesh and Blood Avengers butler, not an AI like in the films, is suddenly tied up by an an arriving Yellow Jacket who says he's come to sign up. Black Panther brings up that the Avengers don't just accept anyone, but Hawkeye is a lot more blunt in his response.
The Panthers got on his Sunday manners, pal, but not Hawkeye. So you put the bite on three small-time punks? So what? And what makes you think that Hank won't show?
I don't think. I know. Cause I'm the guy that polished him off.
Wasp faints from the shock of this claim in a very overdramatic manner. The rest of the Avengers demand to know what Yellowjacket's words are supposed to mean, causing the vigilante to tell his little story. Said story is a complete fabrication, but it indicates that Yellowjacket has supposedly left Hank to the mercy of a spider at a microscopic size. The Avengers, Wasp included as she's woken up, collectively brand Yellowjacket as either a blatant liar or the murderer of one of their closest friends. The Avengers leapt into battle against Yellowjacket, ultimately ending with Yellowjacket managing to kidnap Wasp and retreat. In a secret lair, Yellowjacket attempts to impress Wasp with what its base is like. Understandably, Wasp attempts to strike him and force him to release her. Yellowjacket stops her and forces her into a kiss. Yeah, no surprise that this didn't get adapted. In the aftermath, Yellowjacket seems to be overtaken with guilt and falls back, allowing Wasp to go, only for her to think something incredibly strange.
I'm sorry, doll. I don't know what came over me. Don't need you as hostage anymore. May as well let you go.
Yes, of course. But somehow, now I don't want him to.
I don't like this scene. I really don't like this scene. I hope I don't need to explain why. Continuing on, back to the story, the other three Avengers track down Wasp's homing beacon and find both Wasp and Yellowjacket exiting City Hall. Black Panther immediately attacks Yellowjacket, only for Wasp to call out for her teammates to stop. Why? Because...
I'm going to marry him.
Yeah, we gotta go to the next issue to explain this one. Issue 60 begins with Captain America receiving an invitation to the wedding of Wasp and Yellowjacket, and rightfully questions what the hiffle is going on. Cap storms into Avengers Mansion and gets the rundown from the active Avengers roster, who are unable to bring in Yellowjacket due to not having Hank's supposed body as evidence for the murder. It's not long before Yellowjacket and Wasp arrive on some mind-boggling device. Sorry, pausing the video for a second. What is that supposed to be? Some kind of broken eggmobile? The only visible jet is on the bottom, so is it constantly flying up and horizontal and dropping down by cutting the jet, or... I have too many questions about this thing. Moving on! As Yellowjacket arrives, we get our first meeting between him and Cap, who is evidently put off by the man. When Hawkeye starts calling out Yellowjacket and Wasp on their decisions here, Wasp confides that yes, she still loves Hank, but he always let her money and his research get in the way of them, and now she supposedly has a new chance at happiness. We then get an introduction to the issue's villains, the Ringmaster and the Circus of Crime, before Crystal, an inhuman and current partner of the Human Torch, arrives on the scene, questioning Wasp's decisions as well, only to be met with a simple retort. And this is where we get a piece of inner monologue from Wasp that does work.
If only I were as sure I'm doing the right thing as I sound.
The wedding goes off without a hitch, but a disturbed Hawkeye leaves for the kitchen to see what's up with the cake, only to encounter the Circus of Crime, who he believes is in league with Yellowjacket. Hawkeye falls to the troop, allowing for the cake to be shipped out and for Princess Python's... Python to attack the Wasp. Black Panther and Vision quickly fell the snake, saving their teammate. When Wasp brings up the fact this was clearly an attack on her life, Black Panther theorizes that it may have been done by someone who stood to inherit her riches. That's when the Circus of Crime attacks in full, seeking revenge on a Thor who never showed. When Princess Python traps Wasp again and threatens her life, Yellowjacket is overcome by fear and begins to change. This is when it's finally revealed that Yellowjacket was Goliath all along, transforming into giant size and trouncing the Circus of Crime alongside Wasp, Vision, and Black Panther. As Hawkeye gets himself free and escapes, Hank and Wasp explain what happened. Due to a chemical accident with Hank dropping untested gases and being overcome by his feelings about Wasp, his personality was severely altered and he became a man very much unlike himself. The comic describes this as accident-induced schizophrenia, but I'm honestly not entirely comfortable labeling it as such due to how sensitive of a topic mental health is, and I don't want to get my facts wrong on that front. According to Wasp, she was able to tell it was Hank behind the Yellowjacket mask from the first kiss, and believed she'd be able to help bring Hank back to his normal self. Plus, she could get them to finally tie the knot in the process. Fantastic plan, Wasp. Not a fantastic story. For as much as I like the character of Hank Pym, this was the beginning of his fall for a reason. While Hank's actions as Yellowjacket are explained as mental illness and thus beyond his control, the sudden reversion back to his normal self in the fight with the Circus of Crime doesn't feel earned. not to mention the problematic implications of Wasp's actions in the story. In response to what is legally considered sexual assault, her first reaction is to consider that this man who kidnapped her and claimed to kill her life partner might actually be said life partner? No, the implication is not that Hank forced kisses on Wasp before this, but it's concerning that Wasp made this connection at all. And the whole premise of the wedding feels wrong, both in-universe and out. Fortunately, however, there's a much better take on this same storyline that I encountered in my research, which focuses far more on Hank's mental instability and Wasp's independent actions. Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes Volume 2, a 2007 limited comic series that retells the events from this time period of Avengers comics. If you want to read this version of the story, it's specifically featured in issues 5, 6, and 7. I highly recommend it when compared to the original source. But now that we're familiar with the events of Yellowjacket's comic origins, let's get to the real meat of the video. How was it handled in Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes, the animated series? A bit of context is needed here, specifically on the arc of Hank Pym throughout Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes. This Hank, at his core, is a pacifist. He always strives to help everyone, the villains they fight included, leading to the creation of the Big House, a superhero prison with the aim of providing therapy, and his frequent attempts to talk things out with the villains instead of using brute force. But he also joined the Avengers alongside Janet Van Dyne, the Wasp, as one of the founding members. The contradiction of a pacifistic Avenger is an interesting topic that has already been broken down by my fellow content creator Pillar of Garbage in his video on Ant-Man. So if you're interested, you can check out the link in either the description below or the card up top. When Hank joined the Avengers, he did so for Janet, and in the aftermath of Ultron's corruption and ascension to villainy in Season 1, Hank decided to quit the team.
We can't just let him...
Jan, he's only ever been here because of you. You know that, right? He's a scientist first and foremost. And on top of that, he's a pacifist. He's never liked all this, and he doesn't want to do it anymore. I say let him go.
This wasn't helped by the events of To Steal an Ant-Man, where Hank's Ant-Man gear was stolen by Scott Lang. Hank refused to go to the Avengers, instead contacting the Heroes for Hire and even coming onto the field of battle himself, beating up several of Crossfire's goons. This, combined with the emotional instability Hank displayed in the episode, indicates that this is where Hank crossed the path of no return. So, let's talk about Yellowjacket the episode. The story begins with Iron Man and Wasp arriving at Greyburn College, where Hank has a laboratory set up. One interesting note is that Janet and Tony both come in costume. Tony's come by because Hank wants to show him something, and Pym's racket state indicates that he may not be in the healthiest state at the moment. When it's revealed Hank is actually working on a new version of the Big House that he personally controls, Tony tries to indicate that Hank may not be thinking straight due to his broken and sleepless state, offering to take him down to Stark Tower to work alongside friends. Janet likewise asks Hank to put down his project and talk to them. An interesting note here is that Hank, while trying to do a very distorted and weary version of Hank Pym things, is willing to talk to Tony but unwilling to talk to Janet. When both of them try to get him to stop and take some time to be with friends, he rejects them and gets them to leave, in particular, when Janet does it. On their way out, Janet indicates that Hank definitely needs help and they need to find a way to help him. But they don't get the chance, as the lab explodes. Wasp finds Hank's damaged goggles, indicating that he may now be dead. After the opening credits, we're shown a funeral put on in the Avengers Mansion with all major superheroes in attendance. When Janet runs off, she encounters Nick Fury, who reveals some new information. SHIELD found a detonator in the wreckage of the lab, indicating that Hank was murdered. When the Avengers convene over this, they believe that the Serpent Society was responsible and prepare to hunt them down. When Captain America and Black Panther go on the prowl for the Constrictor, they find him in the middle of being hunted down by a mysterious vigilante.
I'll give you whatever you want. Just let me go!
What I want is to see scum like you punished once and for all.
But who are you?
The name's Yellowjacket.
Cap and Panther are stalled by Yellowjacket long enough for him to blast Constrictor, which is when Wasp, who was supposed to stay behind, arrives on the scene. Upon seeing her, Yellowjacket leaves, only for Wasp to chase him down and knock him onto a rooftop.
Do you realize what you've done? Constrictor was our only lead to finding out who killed Hank.
So? Pym was the weak link in your little club. You're better off without him.
You don't know anything about him!
I knew enough to get rid of the guy.
What?
With the supposed killer of Pym revealed, Janet attempts to take down Yellowjacket, only for him to bust a water tower and fly off. But as she finds a drowned Yellowjacket on her arm, the truth clicks.
Hank?
Janet tells the Avengers, and none of them believe it's Hank because of how different his technology, signatures, and personality are. Meanwhile, Hawkeye sees an excerpt about Yellowjacket on TV, indicating the Busy Wasp has taken down two more members of the Serpent Society. Another cut to Yellowjacket taking out a fourth member of the society before he's jumped by Thor. Thor chases Yellowjacket through the city, the Avengers making pursuit, but too late to stop Thor from being seemingly struck down. The Avengers arrive to confront him and, well, I'll let this scene speak for itself.
You should have just left me alone. I had it under control!
No, you didn't. You never did. You're not Yellowjacket. You're Hank Pym.
Hank, you need help.
Me? I just shut down an Asgardian. You said I wasn't tough enough. Looks like I'm tougher than all of you. Don't even, Clint. I mean it. None of you can stop me.
You can't shoot all of us at once.
He doesn't know what he's doing. Please, just stop it, Hank.
Hank Pym is dead.
Sorry you feel that way, Yellowjacket.
Iron Man blasts Yellowjacket's gun in self-defense, the blast consuming the entire team, and its true purpose revealed at last, as the micro-prison Hank developed at the beginning of the episode is left behind, the full team now trapped inside of that prison, and Thor revealed as alive. Yellowjacket's gun never killed anyone, it shrunk the Serpent Society inside of the prison, but the prison itself is flawed. As Iron Man reveals, it's shrinking itself into oblivion. The Serpent Society escapes their restraint and decides fighting the Avengers is more important than escaping impending quantum annihilation. The team is taken down without much trouble, all save for Constrictor, who grabs Wasp and threatens to rip her apart. Instead of using brute force, Yellowjacket sends forward some Yellowjackets to distract Constrictor, Iron Man blasting the villain the second Janet is out of his grasp. And Hank Pym catches her, some semblance of his original self coming through as he unmasks and hugs Janet. With his science brain back, Hank makes a quick escape plan and manages to get the Avengers and the Serpent Society out of the prison moments before it shrinks to quantum. But as Hank returns to see his own memorial in the aftermath, it's clear that not everything is alright with Pym.
I think we spent too long wanting you to be someone you weren't, instead of appreciating who you were.
You want an Avenger who gets the job done right. Here I am.
Hank Pym is welcome back to the team anytime. That's who we want.
I told you. The name's Yellowjacket.
The episode ends with Janet making a plea to Tony, asking him to let Hank back onto the team as her one request. With a call to action, Yellowjacket flies off to respond to the new threat as Iron Man and Wasp chase behind. It shouldn't be a surprise that EMH's take on the origins of Yellowjacket are much better than the original 60s story. Wasp is still the first to recognize Hank, and their bond remains the way Hank comes back to himself. Elements of snake-themed villains being a core component of the story are still present. Not to mention, the media seems taken by Yellowjacket, much as Jonah was in the comic. What's different is the actual progression of the story. Hank's supposed death is something believed by all the Avengers, and instead of Janet getting kidnapped and arranging a marriage to get Hank back, she hunts down Yellowjacket and is ultimately the one who reveals his true identity to the rest of the team. Another major difference is Iron Man's role in the story, and how his friendship with Hank affects his actions in that tale. But that sounds like the topic for a future video. As for this video, we've now seen both versions of the character, so what does this mean? What's the point in this twist on Hank Pym's character? Who is Yellowjacket? I knew I wanted to have my facts well in order, so in preparation for this video, I sat down and read a bunch of Avengers comics and rewatched several key EMH episodes. In looking at the 1963 Avengers comics from issue 28 onwards and Hank's focus episodes in EMH, I think I got a strong understanding of what makes up these two characters and the differences between them. 616 Hank Pym is a scientist, but he's also a warrior. Taking on the Ant-Man identity was never an obligation for him. When he retired from superheroics initially, it was due to his concern over the Wasp. Safety. After all, she had been shot during the first year of the Avengers run. But with this more battle-focused Pym comes a Pym with plenty of issues. He takes on a controlling nature in his relationship with Janet, a typical thing for men of the 60s but still a slightly worrying one, claiming that he shouldn't have let her transform into the Wasp when she got into trouble. Likewise, Hank deals with severe anger issues but seems to recognize it. When he lashes out at Hawkeye, he immediately apologizes and says he'll submit himself to the Avengers' disciplinary action when they resolve the case. Janet herself itself is a curious case as well. Janet claims that she's only with the Avengers in order to catch Hank's eye, implying that, at least at this point, her investment in the superhero lifestyle was relatively shallow. EMH Hank Pym is an incredibly different character. Hank is a pacifist, and he believes above all else that supervillains should be reformed. He disagrees with the use of violence on an ideological level, but has become accustomed to fighting in order to protect others. He sees the best in everyone, but the world itself disagrees with him. Every time Hank tries to do good, it's used to hurt people. Hank made the Big House only to lose authority over it and for the Big House's true purpose, reforming supervillains, to be completely ignored by the cynical Fury. Hank joined the Avengers only to become disillusioned with the team and failing to reform the Serpent Society despite his best efforts. Hank made Ultron to protect people, only to be forced to teach him the concept of violence to fight Kang and having that backfire tremendously. Speaking of Ultron, the treatment of Ultron in the show informs Hank as well. Ultron was supposed to be unable to kill, but the only person in the world he was unable to hurt was Janet. The Avengers had no such safeguards, allowing Ultron to dispatch the team. Considering what we know of Hank's methodology, it's possible that he would someday see the Avengers as a threat to pacifism, if we consider Ultron's beliefs as an extremist extension of Hank's own. Janet is also quite different. As Pillar of Garbage went over in his video on her character, again check the description or the card above, EMH's Wasp is a thrill-seeking heroine who serves as the heart of the Avengers and makes it part of her very identity. Janet does believe punching supervillains is the right thing to do, but she shares Hank's views that prisons have failed society and how everyone can be better if they put in the effort. The true difference between Hank and Janet is their methodology, and that methodology is what drives them apart. So what does this say about Yellowjacket? In both continuities, Yellowjacket is a breaking point, but Yellowjacket in 616 came about through very different means. At this point, Hank had been dealing with slowly worsening anger issues and struggles with his size-changing powers. The Pym particles were taking a toll on him. Combine that with a desire to marry Janet, but finding himself unable to spend time with her due to his experiments, he finally snapped and Yellowjacket was born. He killed Hank Pym, becoming the action-loving superhero who could spend all day taking down bad guys and hanging out with Wasp. It's my belief that in the original story, Yellowjacket filled the role of a Jekyll and Hyde-like escapism for Hank. He wasn't happy with who he was, so he tried to be someone else, deluding himself into believing he'd killed what he considered the worst part of himself in the process. In contrast, EMH Yellowjacket has more nuance behind him. Instead of being a conflict with his own worst traits, Hank snaps as a response to the society around him. Fury told him he was wrong for trying to help villains. The Avengers told him he was wrong for seeking a better option than fighting. Ultron told him he was wrong for using science to benefit humanity. Janet told him he was wrong for leaving the Avengers. Janet was in denial until Hank finally cleared out. Ant-Man returned during Loki's conquest of the Nine Realms, concerned for Janet's safety and saving her. But when Hank finally returned to Avengers Mansion, it was to take what was left in his lab and leave for good. Janet denies that Hank is leaving, even when he's in his street clothes and actively points out that being with the Avengers isn't good for him. Hank's right though. The Avengers aren't a solution to the world's problems, and staying with them is incredibly self-destructive, dragging down his mental state. When he confirms he's leaving for good, Janet seems to think that he's leaving her as well, and his non-responsive state when looking at the TV seems to confirm this. And when Hank dies and becomes Yellowjacket, it happens directly after Iron Man and Wasp, his two closest friends and former teammates, tell him even this final solution of the miniature prison is wrong. So he accepts that violence is the right answer. He accepts that the right thing to do is beat up criminals, lock them up without remorse. He targets the Serpent Society, the group emblematic of his failures to help supervillains reform, and takes them all down himself. He does the exact thing that Hank Pym would have hated himself for doing. Why does he do this?
What, are you calling to quit again? I get it, Hank. You're not Avengers material. You made it perfectly clear. I just didn't want to believe it. Well, I'd never sit around and cry about things like Ultron. I'd do something about it. So the question is, Hank, what do you want?
I just wanted to tell you that I'm sorry.
Yellowjacket isn't an escape. It's him embracing what the world wants him to be. It's him embracing what he thinks Janet wants him to be. Yellowjacket is the one who deals with villains permanently, taking them out of the picture. After all, isn't that exactly what Janet wanted him to be? If I haven't made it clear enough, Hank Pym's a character that I care a lot about. So, when Pillar of Garbage mentioned in his Discord server that he was working on a playlist with other creators to promote the next Save the Yosverse event, I knew I had to join in. And thus, this video was created for Earth's Mightiest Playlist. For those not aware of what Save the Yosphorus is, it's a trend event on Twitter where various people try to bring attention to the Yosphorus shows. The Yosphorus is comprised of shows and animated movies Christopher Yost was responsible for. Most notably, Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes, Wolverine and the X-Men, Hulk Versus, and Thor, Tales of Asgard. The latter of which will be having its release anniversary on May 21st, which is the day the next trend event takes place. I've linked the host's tweet about the event below. And if you're stumbling across me for the first time through the playlist, hi, I'm Mechanist Gamma. I mostly do Sonic content, but my Mechanist Gamma original series allows me to cover various types of content. If you want to see more comic stuff from me, check out my community posts for Mechanist Gamma Community Comics, where I work my way through various comic series. Occasionally. I haven't done them in a while. Hope you stick around. If you do, it's great to have you here. Special thanks to the Majin V, Swaggy Llama Queen, and Hyper Voice Acting for voicing Yellow Jacket, Wasp, and Hawkeye, respectively, during the comic analysis. Thanks for watching the video, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye!